like to welcome you here and thank you for coming and supporting them. It is always a testimony of the faithfulness of the people of God and when you show up and support the family this way. So we want to thank you for doing that. I just want to let you know that in your bulletins will be all of the music and everything you will need to follow along in this service, and so we would refer you to there. And so we would like to just begin our time with a word of prayer as we open this service. Lord God, we thank you for this gathering. We thank you for Ted's faithful life, and today we want you to be honored through what is said here. We want your mercy and your grace to be seen, and the hope that we have in you to be evident. Lord, we commit this service to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our call to worship comes from Psalm 90. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, where you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn people back to dust, saying, "Return to dust, you mortals." 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Let us stand together and sing, "Guide me out, O great Jehovah."
His song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God.
Join us in the responsive reading. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
When the wicked advances against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent, and set me high on a rock.
Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord.
Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me.
My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek.
Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me. God, my Savior, though my father and my mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me.
Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors.
Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations.
I remain confident of this.
I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart, and wait for the Lord.
Thank you. On behalf of our family, thanks for your presence here today at the service of remembrance and thanksgiving for the life of Theodore Tel. Dad's fingerprints are all over this service. As his end drew near, he began to make remarks about what songs he would like for people to sing together, which psalms might serve as our communal prayers, what scripture he would have read and preached, and of course, the inclusion of the first question from the Heidelberg Catechism. He spoke and we took notes. The one thing Dad did not want at this service was a eulogy. And so we offer these words not to eulogize Ted Tel, but rather to offer a testimony to God's grace and faithfulness, and to return thanks to our Heavenly Father for Dad's life. Dad was born on April 1, 1932, near Trevispo, a small town in Friesland, the Netherlands. His given name was Tanka. He was the first child born to Sjoerd Tel and Renske Wiegersma, to which 11 siblings would be added, 9 of them sisters. You can read their beautiful Frisian names in the obituary at the back of the program. A large family such as this calls for discipline, and his mother's most certainly provided for this. But what he mostly spoke of was his parents' love of Jesus and how they raised their children in the fear and the love of the Lord. My dad's siblings would often tell us that he had the most perfect temperament to be the oldest child in such a large family. The recall of boisterous gaggle of girls playing in the living room, even crawling all over him, and once in a while he would join in the wrestling or crack a joke, but for the most part he would pensively attend to his reading, slowly turning the pages of the book or newspaper. This proved to be wonderful testing grounds for his own eventual busy family. Shortly after World War II, Dad's family made plans to emigrate to Canada. His father did not pass the health inspection, and so these plans were abandoned. While many of his siblings were relieved, Dad was disappointed, and he never could shake the urge to immigrate to this land of opportunity. He had a spirit of adventure, and I think an independent streak. He immigrated to Southern California in 1956. He was in his mid-20s by then, but some of his siblings were still very young. Nevertheless, strong bonds were formed. This despite my dad's aversion to writing. When you received a letter from Ted Tel, it was a very special thing indeed. But his brothers and sisters followed Dad in their thoughts, and through telephone calls, and eventually through overseas trips. This familial love was nurtured and endured to the end, as is evidenced by the many warm messages we have received from our uncles and aunts in the Netherlands. We are glad Tante Anna, Mom's twin sister, could be with us today. But we know that Mom and Dad's other siblings are very much present with us today in spirit. Returning now to our timeline. After immigrating to California, Dad met his life partner, an equally adventurous and independent Frisian immigrant, Tina Kasker. Not having met each other's families, they returned to the Netherlands to be married on April 19, 1961. They settled back in Southern California, where Dad was a laborer at a dairy farm. In 1962, the children started to come, and my head spins when I think of it. By 1965, they had 3 children, aged 2 and under. And as if that wasn't enough, it was in that year that they took the plunge and moved to Auburn, Washington, where Dad could begin operating his own dairy farm. Children 4 and 5 were born there. The family completed, there would be one last move in 1970, this time to Graham, where Dad had the opportunity to purchase and operate his own farm. One thread that is woven through our dad's life was his concern for the spiritual welfare of his children. Part of this, and this remained to his death, was his support for Christian education. Throughout his quest to find a farm where he could raise his family, two important criteria had to be met. The farm must be within reasonable distance to both a Christian Reformed church and a Christian school. Already in Auburn, they had affiliated with this church. Arthur and I were baptized here. And by 1970, George and Peter were attending a Christian school in Seattle. While a move to Graham would actually cut down the commute to church, the question of a Christian school still hung in the air. The story goes that as Mom and Dad were looking over the Graham property and considering the purchase, a yellow school bus dropped off some children at a neighboring house. As Mom and Dad were beginning to imagine the possibilities of putting down roots there, the school bus rambled by. Dad was certainly open to signs from God, so when they saw the school bus and it said Bethel Schools, he thought, and we will have bus service to the Christian school. Though you might consider this sign to be misleading, Dad would beg to differ. Dad would say that this is a demonstration of the prodding and the providence of God. He would soon learn that Bethel School was not a Christian school. Nevertheless, that yellow school bus helped him to decide to buy the farm. Dad and Mom would eventually discover Tacoma Baptist Schools, and though it was not close, and though tuition would prove to be a hardship for a young family investing in a new farm, Dad was steadfast in his commitments. All five of his children would receive a Christian education. Looking back, we see God's hand at work and we give thanks. We had a wonderful time as a family on the farm. There is nothing better than to be able to love your work, and Dad loved his. Many of you of this church have marveled at my father's boisterous singing and worship. This joy and song was not limited to church. Our milking parlor was an acoustical wonder. I sometimes referred to it as Dad's bovine cathedral. And sometimes, oftentimes, perhaps all times, as he milked the cows, psalms and hymns literally echoed in the barn and reverberated beyond. And this is not an exaggeration. Our neighbors could hear him, and we all agreed. It was so beautiful. For Dad, work was both joy and worship. Eventually, Dad slowed down. George built Mom and Dad a house at the corner of the property on a hill overlooking the dairy. But for a farmer, there is never retirement. Until just a year ago, Dad would still go daily to the barns to help feed the cows and to walk the fences and to mow the fields. He was sort of sad to hang up the milking machines, but he said they did their job. And by that he meant that they were a means to help him care for and educate his children. Even as the family shrunk down to just Mom and Dad, rather than decreasing the yield of the vegetable garden, Dad redoubled his efforts. With great satisfaction, he would bring the harvest into the garage. Mom would sometimes be exasperated and say, "We can't eat all that." Well, then Dad would bring some of it to the food bank, and some of it would find its way to the fellowship hall here at church. But more than anything, Dad loved life. He loved those around him, particularly his family. Until very recently, you would see him cheering on his grandchildren at their sporting events, attending every school program and musical concert. When his children, and then their children, and later their great-grandchildren walked through the door, his arms would fly in the air, there would be some vocal outburst, and his face would light up. His embrace of life is reflected in his choice of charity at his passing, Bethany Christian Services, a social service agency dedicated to the belief that every child needs and deserves a loving family. Dad was intensely pro-life, and you can imagine that it was cognitively very difficult for him to let go of his. In his last months, his strength for focused attention became limited. Eventually, and very reluctantly, he let go of the gardening, attending church services, and then reading and television. This was very hard for him, as well as for those around him. But it was the most beautiful thing to be with Dad in his last weeks, because all the focus was on whomever he was with. To be with Dad these last weeks was to be intensely present with him. Dad's fingerprints are all over this service. He didn't want stories about himself. We've slipped a few in, and you have stories to tell too. And we will tell them to each other at the reception and in the weeks and years to come. But for an occasion such as this, there is only one story that Dad would want recounted. And that is the story of God and God's redeeming love. I love to tell the story. It will be my theme in glory. To tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. This is what Dad would boast in. And what he would want us to point to. And what he included in every prayer that he spoke in our home. And we thank thee, dear Father, for sending thy one and only Son to pay for our sins on the cross of Calvary. His life gave witness to Christ, and we must continue to do the same. We give heartfelt thanks to God for the life.
It isn't surprising to me that Ted would have requested that the service today be more about God's faithfulness than his own. You know, many memorial services, we hear stories of all the amazing things that someone has done in their life. We hear stories of how that person has touched the lives of others. And those are good stories. On this earth, we can have an impact in the lives of people for generations. But eventually, over time, our impact isn't as profound. Eventually, every single one of us is going to be forgotten. In a few generations, our impact will only be seen in the family tree that hangs on the wall or that sits in our Bible on the coffee table. Ted wasn't a foolish man. He didn't spend his whole life working hard to raise a family only to have an earthly impact. I believe that Ted had this deep-rooted belief that the reason he lived, the reason he worked, the reason he raised a family was to bring honor, not to himself, but to God. That is who he was. And as a result of that, he has had a huge impact. We see that impact in his marriage. See it in his children, his grandchildren, and his great-grandchildren. But Ted's impact in your life is an eternal one. He taught you and he modeled to you how to love Jesus Christ. He taught you that you are not your own, but that you belong body and soul in life and in death to your faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. That is an eternal impact. Anything less than that is a life of temporal accomplishment. Yes, some of them great, but temporary. Ted knew that all of what we do in this life is hinged on one thing, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. How do I know that? Well, listen to the verse that he wanted us to read today. It's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to start by reading verses 16 through 20, and then later 51 through 58. We'll actually begin with 16 through 19. Paul says, "For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Paul is arguing against the belief that this life is all there is. It was a belief that the Sadducees, the Jewish Sadducees held, as well as many others in the pagan world of Corinth. And it's a belief that many of our neighbors hold to this day. And Paul argues that this belief is hopeless and meaningless. In fact, he says, if it were true, then we are all to be pitied. Because without the resurrection, there is no victory over sin. Without the resurrection, there is no victory over death. But he doesn't leave us there. Listen to verse 20. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The resurrection of Christ is not only the hope we have, but it is the assurance of our own resurrection when we put our trust in him. His resurrection defeats our sin. His resurrection defeats the power of death. You, Ted's family, you who knew him well, knew that Ted had no doubt that when he breathed his last breath here, his next breath would be breathed in the presence of his Savior. And when you have that faith, what power does death have over you? Paul described it in verses 51 through 57. He said, listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep. We will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Sin kills us. The law condemns us. But Jesus frees us to live eternally. In his resurrection, Jesus becomes the death slayer and the life giver. This truth is the truth that your dad and your grandfather, as well as your mom and your grandmother, has imparted to you. That is his greatest honor. Not how many farms he worked or how many cows he milked. As you already heard, those were just tools. His greatest honor is that he led you to the giver of life. There is no higher honor. When Ted is long forgotten by generations to come, and when we're all long forgotten by generations to come, Ted's impact will remain because his impact is eternal. So what do we do with this knowledge that Ted wanted us to remember today? We do it, verse 58 says, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. The hope of the resurrection, the hope and the knowledge and the trust that Ted is alive and is well and is with his Savior is what helps. helps us to stand in this moment is what it inspires us to live our lives as Ted lived his, to the glory of our risen Savior. We are not our own. We belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. And because we belong to Him, Christ, by His Holy Spirit, assures us of eternal life and makes us wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for Him. Family and friends, I hope you find great peace, comfort, and healing in the truth of the resurrection. God's eye twinkled. Ted was raised. Leah's going to come sing for us. And she's going to sing two verses. And then on the third verse, we'd like to ask you that are able to stand and sing that third verse with her.
Thank you.
Let's bow in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for my dad. And as I speak for all of us who share in this time of celebration and loss and thanksgiving, thank you for their friend, confidant, leader, papa, father, and husband. Father, I thank you for his shortcomings, his vulnerability, and his constant reminder to us in this and with this to place our anchor in you, who are the perfect, who are perfect in every way, and fully meet our every need through the riches that are in Christ Jesus. Father, I thank you for his faithfulness and devotion, song, deeds, and prayer, as an example for us to know where our hope comes from. Father, I thank you for the promises fulfilled in your Son through his death, burial, and resurrection, so that we too will be raised as Christ was raised, as the gospel declares, for those who have entrusted their life to your Son. Father, I thank you for your Holy Spirit who comforts, indwells, strengthens, enlightens, and seals us with the seal that bears the image of your Son as a deposit guaranteeing the substance of our faith to the day of redemption, as we see and we celebrate today's with Ted. Father, it is your work that we rejoice and are comforted with, even in an event that the world sees no hope but only despair. We do not grieve as those who have no hope. Lord, we know of certainty that Dad, Ted, is with you. And that though at this time we are separated by death, we know that when it comes our time to be present with you, we will also be united with those that have preceded us in death. As David proclaimed about his infant son who died, "Can I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he will not return to me." Father, thank you for this wonderful time of celebration, reflection, comfort, thanksgiving, and praise. As we experience today, thank you for the life of Tim, for her experience with him, your gift to us. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. We pray, amen.
Please join me in the reading of Psalm 150. Praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary.
Praise him in his mighty heavens.
Praise him for his acts of power.
Praise him for his surpassing grace.
Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet.
Praise him with the harp and lyre.
Praise him with the timbrel and dancing.
Praise him with the strings and the pipe.
Praise him with the clash of the cymbals.
Praise him with the sound of the cymbals.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you. let's close today with the prayer to the Lord. O Lord, support us all the day long until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then in thy mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you. Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son and make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me to life. I know that it is finished. Oh, oh. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
I will not boast Love.